Okay, welcome to this lecture on multi-loop renormalization. Let us begin with a few words of motivation. So in elementary particle physics, we have at the moment the situation that the LHC experiments are running, and so far they have not identified any strong deviation from standard model predictions. And if we go back in time a few decades, for example, 20 years back in time, it was also the situation that the standard model had agreed with all experimental data that was present, let's say, 20 years ago. But at that time, it was totally conceivable from the theoretical and experimental point of view that at the LHC, we would identify huge deviations from standard model predictions, qualitative differences, for example, new particles or new interactions, or that the LHC would find and measure very different coupling strengths between the Higgs boson and other particles. But that has not turned out to be the case. Instead, the LHC data agrees also very accurately with all standard model predictions. But still, we know that the standard model cannot be the ultimate description of nature at fundamental distances. Therefore, there must be physics beyond the standard model, and we need to identify it. But because of this current situation, the next decade in particle physics will be dominated to a large extent by precision. We need higher precision, both in experiment and in theory, and the next decade of LHC experiments are definitely devoted to higher precision measurements of all observables, and therefore also in theory we need to make progress in getting higher precision predictions, both in the standard model and also in competing alternative theories for physics beyond the standard model. And that is what we are here for. One of the many subtopics in getting higher precision predictions is multi-loop calculations of multi-loop amplitudes for physics processes. And another subtopics in the field of multi-loop calculations is multi-loop renormalization. And here is a list of literature references just to give you an idea for the experts. What you can see from those references is that in this semester we will work exclusively in the framework of dimensional regularization. And the underlying theme of the lecture is topics like all order proofs of renormalizability, and then going to details such as quantum action principle, theorems, Slavnov-Taylor identities, symmetry breakings imposed by the regularization, and symmetry restoration by appropriate renormalization. That is the underlying theme, but in case you don't know what I am talking about, that will come over the course of the semester. But today we will start, and we will start with chapter one, which is important examples. And preliminary mathematics. Preliminary mathematics. And we will begin within this context with the gamma function. So let us have some fun with the gamma function and let's call it friends of the gamma function. Let's have a look at this integral. Everybody these days is talking about exponential functions. So it's a very hot topic, not only in particle physics. So let's look at this graph, e to the minus t. What is the area under the curve here? Who knows it? It's one, right? So this is the integral from 0 to infinity, dt e to the minus t. And this integral is 1. Then exponential decay. And now let's look at a second function. So this is t times e to the minus t. What is this integral? 0 to infinity dt, t times e to the minus t. What is that integral? This integral is also 1. So the area under the red curve is the same as the area under the white curve. And how can we calculate it? We can calculate it by partial integration. So this integral can be integrated by doing partial integration. We take the derivative of the second function here. That gives minus e to the minus t times t in these limits, minus then the integral over the derivative of this here, minus integral over the derivative is t to the 0 e to the minus t dt. And then in the limits 0 and infinity, this first term vanishes. And the second term, by the way, plus because of minus times minus, the second term is the integral from before, so we get 1. Okay, so we have calculated two integrals. What about a third integral? Let's change it here in colors. Let's take a function t to the n. Integral t to the n times e to the minus t. Then we can do the same trick, t to the n here. And here in the derivative, we get n times t to the minus n minus 1. So we get a recursion relation for such integrals. And that means now we have a motivation for a function which is the definition of all those integrals, and we have learned a recursion relation for this function, and that is the gamma function. So the definition of the gamma function is exactly this integral, gamma of a variable z is defined as the integral from 0 to infinity dt t to the power z minus 1 by convention times the exponential decay e to the minus t. And the integral is defined mathematically for in the complex plane, and it's convergent for real part of z bigger than 0. So it's actually also defined for complex values, but here we have, of course, assumed real values, but that is not the point. And what we have learned from this integration here is the recursion relation gamma of z plus 1 is equal to z times gamma of z. This is exactly the calculation I have done here. And what we have also learned here from the same recursion relation, gamma of 0 is 1, and gamma of an integer n in general is n minus 1 factorial. So the gamma function interpolates or generalizes the factorial function. Now, in mathematics, the gamma function is investigated in great detail, and we take over some results, for example, the Taylor expansion. So you see, what is the Taylor expansion of gamma around 1? So you see, this is gamma of 1, of course, and not gamma of 0. Gamma of 1 is 1. Gamma of 2 is also 1, because gamma of 2 is 1 factorial. So gamma of 1 is 1, gamma of 2 is also 1, gamma of 3 is bigger than 1. Therefore, the gamma function in a plot, gamma of 1, 2, 3, would behave like this. Here it's 1, here it's also 1, here it's bigger than 1. So it behaves like this. So its derivative at the point 1 is certainly negative, that we can guess. And so if we do a Taylor expansion around 1, we get 1 minus an irrational constant called gamma e times epsilon plus higher orders epsilon square. And this gamma e is the Euler-Mascheroni constant, and it's about 0.57 and so on. Then we need the gamma function in the context of dimensional regularization, because all these ultraviolet divergences of Feynman diagrams are encapsulated in the poles of the gamma function. And here is such a pole, gamma of epsilon for small epsilon, using the recursion relation, can be given by gamma of 1 plus epsilon divided by epsilon. And plugging in the Taylor expansion that we just obtained, we get 1 over epsilon minus the irrational constant plus terms of the order epsilon. And just as an indication, you can go on and evaluate gamma of epsilon minus 1 is then equal to a gamma of epsilon divided by epsilon minus 1. And what happens if you write it like this, then you see gamma of epsilon has a pole that goes like 1 over epsilon. But the denominator here does not have a pole at epsilon equals 0. But for epsilon going to 0, this converges to minus 1. So this simply gives you minus 1 over epsilon plus some other non-divergent terms. And if you think about it, then you can do the same for gamma of epsilon minus 2, gamma of epsilon minus 3, and so on. And you, each time you will find a single pole, 1 over epsilon times some integer plus some non-divergent constants. That means the gamma function has simple poles, 1 over epsilon times a constant, at all negative integers and at 0. And it's a mathematical statement, which we cannot see here right now, that everywhere else in the complex plane, the gamma function is convergent. So much to the gamma function, which is an important ingredient in doing dimensional calculations. Let us now go on and look at a d-dimensional surface element. This is a circle. It's a two-dimensional sphere, if you want. What is the surface of this two-dimensional sphere? In other words, what is the circumference of the circle with unit radius? It is 2 pi, right? So let's call it a surface element in two dimensions, omega 2, and the surface element of the circle is 2 pi. Here is a sphere. That is a sphere. What is the surface of a three-dimensional sphere, omega 3? You know it from spherical coordinates. The surface of a unit sphere in three dimensions is 4 pi, right? So that we know. Now, let us look at the following Gauss integral. A d-dimensional Gauss integral. dke e to the minus k1 square plus and so on plus k d square. This is a d-dimensional Gaussian integral, and this symbol e here denotes Euclidean metric. So we are integrating just in ordinary Euclidean space, a d-dimensional vector k with components k1 to kd, and all the components are squared here with a plus, and then we take e to the minus the sum. So there are two ways to calculate this Gaussian integral. One way is to factorize it, because actually the exponential function is a product of all the individual exponential functions. And therefore, we can split the integral into d factors, one for each dimension. And so this is the first way to calculate it. And the result is obviously one of them to the power d. So one of them is the integral over one dimension dk of e to the minus k square. That is one way to compute the integral, and if we knew what that is, then we also knew the result for the d-dimensional integral. Maybe you know it, maybe you don't, but anyway, this is one way to calculate it. There is a second way to calculate it, and the second way is to use spherical coordinates or polar coordinates in generalized d-dimensions. If we do spherical coordinates, then it is clear that the integrand does not depend on the angles at all. It only depends on the magnitude. Therefore, we can directly evaluate the integral over all the angles, and what we get is one factor of the d-dimensional surface element, omega d. And then what remains is an integral over the radial coordinate, which is dk times k to the power d minus 1, and then the Gauss integral of the radial coordinate. Now we have almost a Gaussian integral, but not quite, because we have a prefactor here. But such an integral reminds us of the definition of the gamma function, because we have an exponential decay times a power function. So by a substitution, we can bring this to the form of the gamma function, and the substitution is, let's say, kappa is equal to k square, then d kappa is equal to 2k dk, and therefore this entire integral can be written as omega d times integral over d kappa over 2 times kappa to the power d minus 2 over 2 times e to the minus kappa. And then we get from this calculation here, this is a gamma function, we get 1/2 omega d times gamma of d over 2. And so we have calculated the d-dimensional Gauss integral in two ways. So one, we have traced it back to a one-dimensional Gauss integral. Two, we have traced it back to a gamma function. And that allows us to draw many conclusions. So first of all, if we plug in two dimensions where we know the two-dimensional surface element is 2 pi, then we can read off from the formula the value of the Gauss integral to begin with, right? Because then we can plug in here d equal 2. Then we know everything. Gamma of 1 is 1. This is 2 pi. And then this gives us the Gauss integral. So from this, we obtain integral dk of minus e to the minus k square is square root of pi. Probably you knew that before, but now we have derived it. Second, if we plug in d equals 3, where we know omega 3 is equal to 4 pi, then we can also look at the formula. And then we get here, the Gauss integral is known. We take it to the third power. And here we have omega 3, which is known. And here we get gamma of 3 over 2. So from this, we obtain the value of gamma of 3 over 2. And using the recursion formula, we can trace it back to gamma of 1/2, which is a nice to know value. And this is also square root of pi. And then we can look at the general formula. And the general formula then gives us the result of the sphere surface element in d dimensions, omega d. We just have to solve it. The Gauss integral is now known. And we can solve in general for omega d. And we get 2 pi to the power d over 2 divided by gamma of d over 2. So we have derived three very nice results. And this result is, of course, something we need in dimensional regularization. Namely, we now have the ability to do d-dimensional polar coordinates. And we can use this as a definition of omega d for all dimensions, even if the dimension is not an integer, but let's say any complex number. The next step after the gamma function is the beta function. The beta function is defined with two arguments, beta of x and y. It's defined as an integral from 0 to 1 dt with an integrand t to the power x minus 1 times 1 minus t to the power y minus 1. Okay, so the integrand means that we have a product of, let's say, two linear functions. And in the integration range, this variable here goes from 0 to 1, and that variable goes from 1 to 0. And we take both variables to arbitrary powers, and then the integral is defined as the beta function. Let's compare it to the following expression. Let's take a product of two gamma functions, gamma of x times gamma of y. We know the definition of these two gamma functions. They are defined as integrals from 0 to infinity. So let's call it the variable now alpha, d alpha times alpha to the power x minus 1, e to the minus alpha, and another integral over a variable beta, beta to the power y minus 1, e to the minus beta. So this is the product of two gamma functions, and you see that in this product, the same kind of two powers appear, namely one variable to this power and another variable to that power. And our desire is to trace back this product of gamma functions to the beta function. So how can we do it? First of all, let's collect the integrals. We have two integrals over alpha and beta, both from 0 to infinity. We can combine the exponential functions, e to the minus alpha minus beta, and then we have isolated these two powers, alpha to this power and beta to the other power. And now we do a variable substitution of the integral, which we will encounter many times during this semester, because you see we have here two integrals which run from 0 to infinity. And one thing we will often do is to have one common variable which runs from 0 to infinity, but we replace the other variable by something which runs only from 0 to 1, which corresponds to the ratio of these two variables. So the substitution we do is the following. Let's call alpha plus beta is the overall variable u. This runs from 0 to infinity in the integration range. And then we define a ratio variable, alpha divided by alpha plus beta, we define as t. Okay. Then we have converted the two variables into one which runs from 0 to infinity and the second one which runs from 0 to 1. And the integration measure is simply like this. So here we can replace d beta is equal to du. And here we can then replace d alpha, if we solve it, is u times dt. Okay. Then this means that our integral can now be written as this, 0 to infinity du and 0 to 1 dt times u. And then we have here the exponential. This is now simply e to the minus u overall. And then these two variables here. And that variable is now alpha. This is t times u. So we get t to the power x minus 1 and u to the power x minus 1, and that beta is obviously 1 minus t times u. So we get 1 minus t times y minus 1 and again u to the power y minus 1. And that means we have factorized our integral into an integral which depends only on the variable u. And this gives a gamma function because we have the exponential of e to the minus u times a power function u to the power 1 plus x minus 1 plus y minus 1. And the rest is the beta function. So this whole thing is the beta function of x comma y times a gamma function. And let's just collect the powers. The powers are u 1 plus x minus 1 plus y minus 1. This gives gamma of x plus y. And so we have traced back the beta function to combinations of gamma functions, namely the full formula is this. It's the product gamma x times gamma y divided by gamma of the sum. That means that any time such an integral appears with two such variables which are integrated from 0 to 1 with arbitrary powers, we can trace back such integrals to gamma functions, which is good to know because such integrals will appear frequently, or in other words, many complicated integrals can be traced back to something like this by appropriate substitution rules. All right, this was the first set of mathematical background that I wanted to give you. Now we will, for the first time, apply it a little bit to quantum field theory calculations. All right, so the second chapter is on the master formula. And again, some friends of the master formula. Let us begin with the Euclidean master formula. This we can derive explicitly. Let us take a Euclidean vector, again denoted by the subscript, which is whose square is simply the sum of all the components squared, all with a plus. Then we calculate the following d-dimensional integral, dd, of this Euclidean vector divided by 2 pi to the power d as a physics normalization. And the function we integrate is 1 over k e square plus some constant q to the power n. How can we calculate this? Okay. The first step is that we can notice that the function I have chosen is spherically symmetric. It depends only on the absolute value square. Therefore, we can use spherical coordinates, and the angular integration is trivial and gives directly the surface element or the surface volume omega d in d dimensions. And the remainder is a one-dimensional integral over the radial variable dk, normalized by 2 pi to the power d, then k to the power d minus 1. And we have the same integrand, k square plus the constant q to the power n. So now we have an integral over one variable, which runs, by the way, from 0 to infinity. And here we have in the integrand something like the beta function. Namely, we have two objects, two different powers, one object to the power d minus 1, another object to the power n. But this object in the integration range goes from 0 to infinity, and that goes from 1 over q to 0. So it's not exactly equal to the beta function, but it's very similar, and by a clever substitution, we can bring it exactly to the form of the beta function. So the substitution is k square is replaced by a variable kappa times the constant q. Then we have 2k dk is equal to the constant q times d kappa. And then we can plug it into the integral. And what do we get? We get omega d divided by 2 pi to the power d times, then we can factor out q everywhere. How many powers of q do we get? K is replaced by kappa times q, so we get overall q to the power d over 2 minus n. And we get from this integration measure one factor 1/2, and then we have d kappa times kappa to the power d minus 2 divided by 2. And the integrand becomes 1 over kappa plus 1 to the power n. Okay. So now you see we have almost the beta function, but still not quite, because this integration variable still runs from 0 to infinity. But here we have again one power, one variable to some power, and this denominator to another power. And using another substitution, this can be brought back to the original definition of the beta function. But by the way, in some references, you would find exactly this integral as the definition of the beta function. So that integral is an alternative way to define the beta function. And it is related to our definition by a substitution. Namely, again, you can substitute kappa by such a ratio variable. So kappa can be written as t divided by 1 minus t. Okay. So then kappa goes from 0 to infinity, and t only needs to go from 0 to 1. And then this ratio goes from 0 to infinity. So this is the substitution that you can do. Kappa plus 1 is then equal to 1 over 1 minus t, if you look at it. Okay. So kappa is this, kappa plus 1 is that. And therefore, if we plug in the substitution, we get t to some power and 1 minus t to some other power. And t goes only from 0 to 1. And the integration measure behaves like this, d kappa by dt. Let's just take the derivative. We need to take the derivative of this with respect to t. We get 1 over 1 minus t plus t divided by 1 minus t square. And if we bring it together, then we get 1 over 1 minus t overall squared. So this is how the integration measure behaves. So if we plug it in, then we get exactly the beta function. And let us write down immediately the result. We get omega d divided by 2 pi to the power d times the 1/2. And the whole thing here, kappa and this denominator, is replaced by t to some power and 1 minus t to some other power. Let's not go through it in absolute detail. You can do it at home and check that we obtain the beta function of d over 2 and n minus d over 2. Okay. Therefore, overall, we can plug in now all the results. And we know what omega d is. Omega d we have calculated before. It is replaced by pi to some power and the gamma function. The beta function can be replaced by some gamma functions. And everything combined gives us 4 pi to the power minus d over 2 times gamma of n minus d over 2 divided by gamma of n times q to the power d over 2 minus n. And so in this way, we have derived a master formula for this integral. This is a master formula. We have a general d-dimensional integral over a radially symmetric function, which looks like this. As you know, this is the generalization of quantum field refinement diagrams with propagators. And in Euclidean space, we can integrate it and express the result as some products of pi factors and gamma functions. And the physics is, of course, contained in this quantity q, which is the only physics quantity the integral depends on. And that q appears to some power. And so for those of you who watch the video at home, and also for those of you who are here, do the derivation completely at home, go through all the substitutions, and check that they work out in the way I explained. Now, as some of you know, there is also a Minkowski space master formula. Namely, in Minkowski space, d dk divided by 2 pi to the power d, 1 divided by minus k square plus a constant q minus I epsilon to some power d, n, where this k square is now a Minkowski space square of Minkowski momentum, which means we have the energy component k0 square minus all the space-like or normal momentum coordinates squared. So this is now a one-dimensional energy component, and this is a d minus one-dimensional momentum. Okay, and this is the Minkowski space k square. If we integrate in this way, then we can bring it back to the Euclidean master formula by looking in a special way at the energy integration. And the energy integration is important and behaves in a particular way because the denominator here can go to zero. And if it goes to zero, the I epsilon prescription here is important. And so when it is almost zero, it is not quite zero, but it becomes imaginary because of the plus I epsilon. And if one evaluates the integral over k0, one can do so by using complex analysis and the residue theorem, and the result is imaginary. And the result can be traced back using the residue theorem to a Euclidean space energy integral, which replaces the Minkowski k square by a Euclidean k square and gets rid of the I epsilon prescription. And if one goes through all these steps, we get essentially the same result, but multiplied with a complex I. This complex I comes from this procedure, which is called Wick rotation of the integration contour. And the rest is as before, 4 pi to the power minus d over 2 times q to the power d over 2 minus n times gamma of n minus d over 2 divided by gamma of n. This is a very important formula for us, for quantum field theory. And the derivation can be found in the quantum field theory 1 lecture, for example, which I did last year. So I will not repeat it here. But later we will do a check of this using other means to show you also alternative ways how one can evaluate those integrals. But let's first look at something else which is important, namely Feynman parameters. So let us evaluate the following integral, dx from 0 to 1, a times x plus b times 1 minus x square. Okay. So this is a homework. If you do this integral, then magically you will find a very simple result, namely the result is 1 over a times b. So a very simple observation by Feynman and also by Schwinger. So going backwards, if you now encounter some denominator with a product and you don't like the product, then the Feynman parametrization gets rid of the product and replaces it by one denominator, which is more complicated, but it's only one factor in the denominator to the power 2. And sometimes that simplifies things. In fact, for us, it will always simplify things, and therefore, this Feynman parametrization is very important for us. And again, in quantum field theory 1 lecture, we did a very strong generalization of this. If you have many, many denominators, let's say A1 to AN, and each denominator is raised to some arbitrary power, let's call it nu 1 to nu n. So you have generalized in two ways. Then you have still a Feynman parametrization, but it's much more complicated and it involves gamma functions. Gamma of the sum of all these powers, sum of all these powers nu I, divided by the product of all the individual gammas of all these powers to which the denominators are raised, times an integral. And for each denominator factor, we have an integral over dx1 up to dxn, all from 0 to 1. But there is a constraint implemented by a delta function, delta of 1 minus the sum of all the integration variables. So they always have to add up to 1. Times the following ratio, namely the product of all these variables xi to the power nu I minus 1, divided by the sum of all the xi's times the denominators ai, and this whole thing is raised to the sum of all the powers nu 1 to nu n. Okay? So that means if you have many factors in the denominator with arbitrary powers, you can still bring it into this form. This is the essential thing here at the end, at the bottom. Namely, we have just one single denominator, and the single denominator is a linear combination of all these individual denominators here. And only this whole linear combination is raised to some uniform power, and that is the simplification. But of course, the rest is extremely complicated, and we have here a multifold integral, but this is an integral in a compact region of integration variables, and that can sometimes be easier computed than an integral over something like this. So it's a very general formula. But also in this generality, it is sometimes useful. And the proof can be found in quantum field theory 1. So I will not go through the proof. It's elementary by just plugging in the gamma function definitions and doing similar substitutions as we have already encountered today. But since this is topic of quantum field theory 1, let's do something else here and introduce something which was not part of quantum field theory 1, namely the so-called Schwinger parameters. Right. So in addition to this Feynman parametrization, we can also do what is called a Schwinger parametrization, or sometimes also called alpha parametrization, because the Schwinger parameters are often called alpha. So, and let's do it directly for a quantum field theory propagator. Let's say 1 over p square minus m square plus I epsilon. This is a quantum field theory propagator, and let's imagine we want to raise this propagator even to some arbitrary power nu. Could be 1, but it could also be epsilon or something else. Then this denominator can be written as an integral minus I to the power nu divided by gamma of nu of the integral 0 to infinity d alpha, alpha to the power nu minus 1. By the way, whoever suggested that the blackboard should be divided into two halves, I don't know what they were thinking. Times e to the I times the propagator times alpha. Okay, and the proof is just by going backwards. Because by going backwards, what happens here, actually, you have to look at I times I epsilon times alpha. This is really minus epsilon times alpha, and epsilon is a small positive number. Therefore, this means we have here a gamma function integral. We have a gamma function, and we just replace, make a substitution. The essential point is the minus epsilon times alpha. This is a real integration which is exponentially decaying. Therefore, the gamma function is completely well defined, but we can make a substitution which takes care of this p square minus m square. So it's important that in the definition of the gamma function, it was well defined for all z in the complex plane as long as the real part of z is positive, and that we are using here. So by doing a substitution, you can just evaluate it. Then, of course, you get gamma of nu, which cancels this. You get from the substitution then minus I to this power and the propagator to the same power. So there is nothing to prove. It's a direct one-line calculation. Now, let us look at something else, namely a Gaussian loop integration. So, imagine you have a Feynman diagram with loops. Then, of course, you want to do a loop integration over an integrand which looks like this. We already had the master formula which does the job, which directly gives us a result for a loop integration over some integrand which has this form. But now imagine you do Schwinger parametrization. If you do Schwinger parametrization, you replace this integrand by an exponential integrand. So what happens if we do Schwinger parametrization is we end up with integrals over a loop momentum d-dimensional k, and the integrand is e to the I times the loop momentum square, which is a Gaussian integral. Therefore, we look at this especially. So we have a d-dimensional k integration normalized to pi to the power d. And let's really look at this, e to the I times k square, and let's also write down the plus I epsilon for consistency. Then this is for each dimension, it's a normal Gaussian integral because this is again a sum over the energy component square minus the spatial components squared. So we have one Gaussian integral with a plus sign and d minus one Gaussian integrals with a minus sign. And each Gaussian integral has this exponential damping, therefore it's convergent. And we can make every of these integral into a normal Gaussian integral with standard normalization by the following substitution. For the energy component, we can do this substitution. Let's replace k0 by x divided by minus I alpha. Okay. If we do this, then k0 square is x square divided by minus I alpha. And then this I times k0 square is just minus x square. And then we have a normal Gaussian integral. And for the spatial components, we do the opposite. We would replace them by x divided by square root of plus I alpha. Then the I times minus ki square also gets minus x square. And we have a normal Gaussian integral. Therefore, we can apply all these substitutions for each integral individually. Then we get each time a normal Gaussian integral times a factor coming from the substitution. And then the result is simply this. For the energy component integral, we get square root of pi divided by minus I alpha. And for the spatial components, we get square root of pi divided by plus I alpha to the power d minus 1, because there are d minus 1 spatial components. And the whole thing is divided by 2 pi to the power d. That is the result of this integral. And we can bring it into a nicer form. The pi factors are combined pi to the power d over 2 divided by 2 pi to the power d. So this gives the famous 4 pi to the power minus d over 2. And then we can collect the factors of I. So here we have minus I to the power minus 1 half. Here I to the power d minus 1 over 2. And so on. So the pi factors work out like this, pi I to the power minus 1 minus d over 2. And then the alpha factors get this power alpha to the power minus d over 2. So we have, let's call it another master formula, a master formula for a loop integration where the integrand is not a propagator, but such a Gaussian exponential of a propagator, something which will naturally appear once we use Schwinger parameters. And using this, we can check our original master formula. Okay. So we have already derived it in the last semester, and here I quote the result. But now we can derive the same master formula independently by combining Schwinger parameters and this Gaussian loop integration. Let's do it as a satisfactory check. Let's I think this has no chance of fitting on this blackboard. So let's do it like this. Let's check the master formula here. D-dimensional K integration in Minkowski space, normalized in the usual way. And the integrand is minus K square plus a constant Q minus I epsilon to some arbitrary power n. And now let us do Schwinger parameters and then apply the Gaussian loop integral. Okay, so this denominator here to the power n is now written using Schwinger parameters as an integral from 0 to infinity over alpha, alpha to the power n minus 1. Here you see we get this alpha is always the power corresponding to this power in the denominator here. times copied from over there, I to the power n divided by gamma to the n times the loop integration ddk over 2 pi to the power d with the integrand I k square minus q plus I epsilon times alpha. And the minus I to the power is replaced by plus I to the power, since in the denominator we have the negative entry. Okay, so now we can calculate this. The loop integration is now exactly this Gaussian integral that we have just evaluated. Therefore, we can write down the result. And the alpha integral remains d alpha to the power n minus 1. Now, from the loop integration, we get an additional alpha exponent, alpha to the power minus d over 2 comes here in addition. Then from the loop integration, we get 4 pi to the power minus d over 2. And from the loop integration, we get more powers of I to the power n plus all the rest of it, I to the power n plus 1 minus d over 2 divided by gamma of n. And then what remains is the actual physics. Namely, what remains is here this exponential of q. We have not integrated over q, so this just remains as a factor, e to the I times minus q times alpha. So what is this? We have an integral 0 to infinity over one variable alpha. Alpha appears raised to some power, and then we have e to the alpha. That is, of course, a gamma function. Therefore, we can again just copy the result. This is directly the definition of the gamma function. And we write down the result. Then the integral is done, and what remains are all these factors. And that's it. And from this gamma function, of course, again, we need to do a substitution because our integration variable is alpha. So in order to make use of the gamma function definition, we have to substitute alpha by I times q times alpha, essentially. Therefore, in the result, we will obtain q raised to some power. Let me write down the result. The result is 4 pi to the power minus d over 2, gamma to the n minus d over 2. This is the result of the integral. And you can see that this gamma function must appear because the gamma function has the argument which corresponds to the exponent of the integration variable plus 1. And this is the exponent of the integration variable. So this comes here. This is the essential result of the integral. Then the rest is just copied from before. I to the power n plus 1 minus d over 2. And now from the substitution, we get minus I to the power n minus d over 2. And then from the substitution, we also get minus q to the power n minus d over 2. Now we can simplify a little bit. Luckily, all these stupid powers of I drop out, essentially. And what remains are some factors of minus 1 raised to the appropriate power, so that out of minus q, we get plus q raised to this power. And then we simply, what remains is exactly one factor of I. Out of all these many, many powers of I, we get I. That's it, times 4 pi to the power minus d over 2 times the ratio of gamma functions times plus q raised to the power d over 2 minus n. And that is exactly the same result as the master formula on the left. So you see, using Schwinger parametrizations and Gauss integrations, we can derive the master formula again. Or all in all, we have a consistent set of equations using Feynman parameters, Schwinger parameters, doing directly such an integration, which could be traced back to the beta function, or this integration, which is a Gaussian integration. It all works out. It is all consistent. And we have one correct result here for all these integrals. But now we are exactly at half of today's lecture. Sorry to tell you.